We have the first speaker for today, that is Mr. Captain Viriato Fernandez. So I'd like to call upon Annalie to give a small introduction.
Good morning, everyone. It is my pleasure to introduce Captain Viriato Fernandez, our first speaker for today. Captain Viriat is the convener of Goincho Awaz and is one of the leading forces in the fight for Goa. After completing his graduation in mechanical engineering, he went on to join the Indian Navy in 1991 and was also awarded a Vijay Star Medal for his participation in the Kargil War. He also has a double MBA and a black belt degree in Six Sigma management. On the verge of starting a second career in a foreign country after quitting the Navy, he called it off and joined thousands of Goans to fight the ill-conceived and destructive Regional Plan 2021. Since then, it has been one battle after the other. And now, he has taken the reins to fight against the plans to convert Goa into a coal corridor. We welcome you, Captain Viriat.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Emily.
Captain, you can begin.
Yeah. Thank you. A very good morning, fathers, sisters, and all my friends, the youth. I just want to tell all the youth, it's a great pleasure that finally, you know, we've connected. I want to also assure you that if we are fighting this battle to save Goa, it's not for me and the fathers and the sisters and our parents. It's a battle to save Goa for you, for the youth. And we have coined a new slogan that youth are not the future, youth are the now. And it is being led by Valerie and all the youth in Chikali. And we have connected with the youth in many, many villages because I strongly believe that it's only the youth revolution which can change the thought process of the policymakers and take Goa to prosperity, happiness, and the land which was a gift from God to us. To begin with, what is this fight about? It's basically because we have come to know, we've got a big research team, very good people, educated young people, and we chanced upon all the documents that there is this project called Sagarmala, where it is intertwined with other projects which are under different ministries of the central government. It only is leading to the destruction of Goa to meet the greed and profit of a few industrialists. Now, this particular battle is around two things. One is coal and one is against the destruction of the wildlife sanctuary and the national park at Mole and damage to the Western Ghats. Now, I won't dwell much into Western Ghats because you all know it is one of the protected structures. It has been listed in UNESCO. And today we are surviving, Goa is surviving purely because we have the Western Ghats which is protecting us. Now coming back to these projects, they have told that this project Sagarmala means Sagar means river or sea. Mala is a garland. So basically a garland of rivers. It sounds nice. They're trying to connect the rivers. They're trying to connect the major ports which are there across India, be it the Mormugao Port Trust, the connecting with the Jawaharlal Nehru Port Trust in Mumbai, and Cochin Port Trust and Chennai, and Vishakhapatnam, and Haldia in West Bengal, Paradip in Orissa. So all these ports are being connected with a good thought process that they will improve the trade and business, import, export, revenue increases, economy gets a big boost. We are all for it. It's a very good concept, but we have reservations against dirty cargo, hazardous cargo coming into Goa. Why? Because Goa is known all over the world for tourism. We have been blessed with you know, pristine beaches, the hills, forests, rivers, greenery all around, beautiful rivers. Just before quitting the Navy, I had this great desire right from childhood, because my parents had instilled this idea that one day you have to go to the Holy Land. You know, you have to set your foot on the land that Christ walked. And before leaving the Navy, I managed to get special permission, because in the defense, it's difficult to visit foreign country. But I was given this permission. When I went there to see this land of milk and honey, believe me, I didn't find it very different from what we have in Goa. They also have beaches, far less as compared to Goa. They have got agricultural land, orchards, forests, I mean, hills, everything what Goa has. So we too, I started believing that Goa also is a land of milk and honey. It's just that it has not been mentioned in the Bible, but I strongly believe. I spoke to some priests who are my friends, and I always go for some guidance, and they said, yes, we are blessed. Now, if that is a gift of God, it's the duty of all of us to fight and protect this land. And for the generations to come, people, kids who are not yet born. And so coming back to this is why we are stopping this coal coming into Goa. Now, coal has been coming into Goa in very small quantities, just about 7.5 million tons till 2013-14. It was coming, and it went quietly and met the needs of some industry in Jindal. Now, subsequently, 2014, there was a change in government in India. And there was speculation, and it was there in all newspapers, all the media reported that there were a few industrialists, very rich industrialists, influential industrialists, who pumped in a lot of their capital, liquidity, their support in kind and in cash to ensure a certain political party comes to power. Now, you should know that when industrialists and businessmen pump in so much of money, that means when their party or the favored party comes to power, they want something in return. They want favorable decisions, policy which will help them to increase their business. So in this case, we saw that certain industrialist called Mr. Gautam Adani, who had landed his aircraft for the campaigning for Prime Minister, and pumped in a lot of money, as reported by the newspapers. He happened to buy a coal mine in Carmichael, the Carmichael mine in Queensland, Australia. So there's nothing wrong. He can buy. But the people of Australia, they're very conscious. Unlike us, now the awakening is happening in India, especially in Goa. But the people in Australia are quite conscious of their environment, of the global warming thing, what is happening, the sea level rise, and they're quite sensitive. When they came on the street, they started protesting when they came to know that Mr. Adani has bought this Carmichael mine. And they said that it's going to give rise to global warming, greenhouse gases will be emitted, and it's going to harm the coral reef, which is at the Great Barrier Reef. And you all must have studied in school, in geography, we have been taught about the continental drift theory, you know, how the continents are held together, and especially the corals play a very big role. And so they believe, and the scientists have also told, that if this mining starts in Queensland, it's going to damage the Great Barrier Reef. So they were protesting there. Now, we subsequently came to know that this coal is going to come into India. Now, don't we have coal in India? We have huge reserves of coal. And again, we have studied in school, in geography. We have states like Orissa, Chhattisgarh, then Jharkhand, West Bengal, Madhya Pradesh, all, you know, somewhere in central India and the eastern side, eastern India. They're having huge reserves, billions and billions of tons of coal. And if you start mining this coal, believe me, it's maybe 10,000 or 15,000 years. It will not get over. Thousands of years, imagine. So why are we not getting that coal? I mean, I'm against the use of coal, because India also is a signatory to the United Nations decision that we are going to reduce coal. We have to play a part in saving the planet. We have to reduce the greenhouse gases. Believe me, it's an irony that our Prime Minister was conferred the award of Champion of the Earth by the United Nations just a couple of years back. And what are we doing today? We are actually going against the agreement what we have signed. And we were tom-tomming about it. The Prime Minister was tom-tomming. Oh, we are signatory. And, you know, he was given that award, Champion of the Earth. And what are we doing? We are letting down the commitment what we signed. So now, we came to know that these mines are not being operated to that extent which can meet the requirement of these industries which require coal. Where are these industries? These industries are spread all over India. But Goa, as far as Goa per se is concerned, the coal that is going to come to Goa is going to go to the industries based in Karnataka and Maharashtra. You know that we are at the south of Maharashtra and above north of Karnataka. So most of these industries are in Karnataka and a few in Maharashtra. They require coal. And we have got a whole list of companies which have given as how much of coal they require per year. Now the state government and our chief minister and environment minister, Mr. Cabral, is on record saying that we are not going to allow coal, and coal is not going to go to these states through Goa, which is a lie. Because these are official documents. You know, I am always against allegations. I never allege. I always talk with facts and figures, and these documents are there with us. So the coal is coming to Goa for onward transmission or transportation into Karnataka and Maharashtra. Now, how is this coal going to go? It's going to come to Mormugao Portras. Now, Mormugao Portras, even if the coal comes, should be in a position to handle so much of coal. Now, how much of coal is coming? It's, as per our calculation and documents that we have, it's going to be 136 million tons per year. Now, 136, you know, 1 million is 10 lakhs, and 1 ton is 1,000 kgs. So you can imagine the amount of coal that is going to come into Vasco, into Mormugao. Now, even if it comes, can Mormugao handle so much of coal? No, they can't handle. They could at present, the present capacity is 12 million tons per annum. But there was a company appointed, ECOM. It's a consultant company. And they prepared an 84-page master plan how Mormugao could be expanded, modernized, bring in new cranes, new equipment, build new jetties, the berths, do dredging, so that big ships can come with coal. And to prove their point, there was a ship which came on 23rd November 2015 called MV Tasik Melati. For the first time ever, such a huge ship with coal entered Goa on 23rd November 2015. And now when we look at it, that was a signal to the central government that such a huge ship can enter with coal, because 2 days later there was the Sagarmala project approved, which gave all the green signals for this type of coal to come into Goa. The Sagarmala project was approved on 25th November 2015. Sagarmala, as I said, the garland of rivers, which was meant for boosting the economy of the country, has suddenly turned out to be, as in Hindi it sounds nice, Fasika Fanda for Goa. It's going to kill Goa. It's going to kill the tourism, going to kill the environment, the health, this gift of God. So, he has paid $2 billion for buying this coal. And when an industrialist like him, influential, close to the Prime Minister, invests so much of money, he is not going to give up, whether it's Goa or any other state. He doesn't mind it getting destroyed. So he wants this so much of coal. The more the coal comes, the more profit he earns. So what happens is, now this company, ACOM, submits this 84-page plan, master plan. It says that the coal which comes, since there's not enough space, they have to start getting more land under their control. In 2017, June 2017, I don't know if you all can recollect, it was there in all newspapers, it is there in my presentation, just a screenshot, where in Baina, they demolished a whole lot of, over about 121 houses of poor fishermen. they demolish the houses, and they said because of the global warming, the sea level rise, and so there will be flooding, and these houses will get washed away, the people may get killed, so they demolished the houses. Now, have you rehabilitated those poor fishermen and the families? No. Have you given them alternate places, rebuild houses somewhere else? No. But where is the land? The land is with empty. So you know how they are grabbing land, throwing out the poor fishermen, throwing out the poor people of Goa, grabbing the land. They have also reclaimed lakhs and lakhs of square meters of land from Zuari. They would have filled with boulders and soil and mud. And accidentally, we came to know because the Mormugao Port Trust approached the survey department that please give a survey number for this land. And the state government, the survey department was quite surprised. I mean, where is this extra land? There's no land remaining where we have to give survey number. And then they discovered that this is a new land which has been formed, reclaimed from the sea. And that's actually an ecological disaster. You're destroying the marine life. You're destroying a river. That is what MPT is doing when you know you come under the influence of such a powerful industrialist who we call as crony capitalists because they influence the decisions of the government. So now what happens is 136 million tons of coal is supposed to come per year. So what do? There's no enough space. You fill up Baina, you fill up Mormugao, Vasco, Dabolim, Chikali. I mean, still there will be no place because so much of coal is coming. So they came out with this idea that as coal is coming, you have to move the coal out of the port. Now, how do you move from Mormugao? You are connected to the outside world by rail. You are connected by road. So these are the two means, most important means to move the coal out of Goa. And then the company says, even if you move by road and by rail, still you will not be able to handle the excess coal because the big boss Adani wants more coal to come. So what do they do? In November 2016, the government of Goa nationalized six rivers. That is Sal, Mapsa, Kumarjua, Shapora, Zuari and Mandovi. So these are the six rivers, beautiful names given by our ancestors. They've been existing for thousands and thousands of years. These six rivers were handed over to an organization, central organization called IWAI, Inland Waterways Authority of India. It is headquartered at Noida, close to Delhi. So we have lost control of the six rivers. Otherwise, these rivers used to be under the control of captain of ports. Now, once they have been handed over to the center, now see how the plan falls in place. That means they have control of the rivers and they can use the rivers the way they want. So now, can you join the dots? The additional coal which is going to come, which MPT cannot handle, will go by the rivers. Now you will say, how by rivers? And where will they go? I mean, rivers have to be connected somewhere. So through RTI, we found another document, a letter written by the Ministry of Shipping, Government of India, to the captain of ports that you have to construct these nine jetties. And these nine jetties are, you know, it's there in my slide. Probably Annalie can show you. These are at Rasai, Old Goa, Ribandar, Aldona, Pilgaon, Bori, all these strategic places. So when we superimposed these jetties, now why it generated a doubt in us? Because there are already jetties which are existing. And you all know that people don't use the ferries to the extent that probably one may use in foreign countries. Because today everyone has got a car, we've got good road connectivity. But then why this nine jetties at such a huge cost, which is your and my money, taxpayers' money? So when we superimposed these jetties with the places, the roads which are going into Karnataka and Maharashtra, we found that the additional 85 million tons, that is 136 minus 51, you remain with 85 million tons of coal per annum. So this 85, could it be that it can be also moved by the rivers? Yes. So when we confronted the government that you are also going to use the river, that means it's going to be a three-dimensional attack on Goa. The destruction of Goa is going to happen by rail, by road and by rivers. And the state government said, where is the proof? Why are you lying? You are lying. You are alleging. There's no proof. And believe me, friends, absolutely there was nowhere written that any of the names of the six rivers that coal is going to be transferred through them. But then we found a document, which probably, again, Annalie can share it. And that document says that the cargo is ready. And what is the cargo? Coal. So they're not saying coal. The cargo is ready. And infrastructure is falling in place. And what is the infrastructure? That letter written by the Ministry of Shipping to Captain of Port, build a jetty. That means if the balance coal is transferred through the rivers, it is unloaded at the infrastructure. What is the infrastructure? The new jetties which are going to come up. And from these new jetties, where are these new jetties? They're getting connected to the national highways. So that means you have to unload the coal at the jetty. And what we have come to know through internal sources, this expansion of roadways which is happening, they are planning it to build, to handle huge lorries to carry 80,000 tons of coal. 80,000. So you can imagine, 80,000 kgs of coal. That means 80 tons of coal will go in one truck, huge trucks. The ones what you see in movies, English movies, you know, where the trucks, lorries are moving in America, those type of lorries. So the mystery gets solved, the dots get connected. So we have this three-dimensional attack, the railways, that is the double tracking. Second is by road, and third is by the rivers. Now, again, you will ask, there is no proof. No name of the river has been written. Now, in that document which we have got, there are names, numbers given to the rivers. You know how you have for roads, once the road is turned into a national highway, they're given numbers like 4A or 17A or 566, National Highway 566. That way, these six rivers which were nationalized have been given numbers. For example, Zuari has been given National Waterways 111. Mandovi has been given the name National Waterway 68. And Kumarjua River has been given National Waterway 27. And these three numbers are there in the document that the ready cargo will go through this infrastructure, that is the jetties, and it will go through number 27, 68 and 111. That solves the mystery. The government has been saying, so when we told the chief minister in our meeting on 13th October, I said, doctor, that is Dr. Pramod Sawa, I said, doctor, this is where it connects. And he kept quiet, you know, silence was admission. And he said, I am with you. I will not allow coal to come. I will not allow double tracking. We will save Goa. But, you know, the pressure from Delhi and from the friends of the industrialist friends of the Prime Minister, probably he took a U-turn, which the previous government was famous for, a U-turn, and he said, no, coal will go through Goa. So, you all know now, I have explained to you, I have shared documents with Annalie, and you all can have access to it. It's an open document. I would love to share this document with as many youth as possible. I'm not saying people, I want youth. You are the now, not the future. You are the now. We are fighting for the future, for a better future of yours. But you are the now. You have to carry out the revolution. Now that you know that Goa is going to be destroyed because of this transportation of coal. Now the next part is the 400 kV line, which is going to come through Mole. Power minister said that there is a shortage of electricity, and you and I are, you know, our life is dependent on electricity, whether for lighting the house or whether for charging our mobiles or for television or name it, you know, you require electricity, and we agree. But we should also not forget that the Prime Minister has signed an agreement at the United Nations that we will go in for renewable energy, sustainable development, sustainable growth. And there's plenty of scope for renewable energy. We've been blessed with sunlight. We've got the waterfalls and the rivers. We can harness this energy. And the government of India set a target of getting about 170 gigawatts, gigawatt GW watts of electricity renewable in a year. But many of the industries, and believe me, Adani is ironically one of the main companies which is producing renewable energy, solar energy. They have achieved, all the companies have achieved 270 gigawatts of renewable energy, which is it's a huge compliment. In that sense, I would compliment the industries, including Adani, that you all have gone in for this. Then why are you bringing this coal, which is going to destroy Goa? So now, coming back to the Mole issue, the line which is coming, 400 kV line, it is coming from this called Narendra line. You know, incidentally not connected with our Prime Minister. Narendra is a town. So that's why it has been named. Now, this line which has come was not the first option. There was a meeting which happened in 2015. The central government and all the states and our chief engineer of the government of Goa was present in that meeting. And the decision was taken that this line will not come damaging the Western Ghat, damaging the forest, damaging the wildlife. The decision was taken. And they had given an option. There are 8 options by which these lines can come. Also, upgrading the existing line, which is the safest means, and you'll have to spend less money for that. But despite all that, suddenly we came to know that somewhere, about less than a year back, somewhere somebody has taken a decision at the highest level to bring this new line, destroying our forest, our wildlife, our sanctuaries, national park. So who, when, and how it has been conspired, we will declare it at the right time. We'll expose the people involved in that. And we will share it with the youth, because we want the youth to know, but at the right time. I come from a military background. I always believe everything should be done at the right time. That is what is strategy. If the government doesn't revert back, we will definitely hit hard exposing that. Now, there are other medical effects which I will not go into, you know, about the radiation when such a line is coming. Now, this line is coming, and when it reaches Sangod in Kole, they are building a substation for the 400 kV line. So I want all of my friends among the youth to know, and some of you all may be having an engineering background. Why is a substation set up? A substation, the use of a substation is to step up the voltage or to step down the voltage. Now, in this particular case, the substation which is being installed at Kole is to step up the voltage. Now, why step up the voltage? You're getting 400 kV line there. And the power minister, Mr. Nilesh Kabral, has said, we are getting 1,000 megawatts power every day, and we are using only 600 to 650 megawatts. Is it possible, Annelie, to show that particular slide, the screenshot of our power minister taking a press conference in June 2019? And saying that we have 400 megawatts of power surplus.
Captain, we are presenting the PowerPoint at the moment. Is it in the PowerPoint?
Yes.
Yeah. Yes. Father Alan, can you please present that?
It's a video?
No. It's a slide, Father. It's a slide. It's a screenshot. I think so. It's a hyperlink where the power, it said 400 kV line. There's only one slide. Same transmission line, 400 kV.
Yes, this one.
In that, there is a hyperlink down below, not the first one.
Railway.
Railway.
No. The first one, digital. I think so. There's one hyperlink on top. Digital Goa something.
Yeah, this one.
Where Mr. Nilesh Kabral is saying, it's a press conference.
Is it a video or the picture?
No, it's a picture. It's a picture.
And there it is.
He says that 400. Megawatts is surplus.
Yeah, it's presented, sir.
So he has told the whole of Goa that we are already having 400 megawatt surplus. And now he probably is being forced by certain authorities, his bosses, to say there is a shortage and the people require. We don't require. We are already surplus. So this now connected to the substation which is coming at Kole. And I'll give you another thought process. Now, when we go by train, all of you all must have, at some point of your life, have traveled in the train from Vasco, or, you know, when you reach Kole, if you recollect, the train stops there. And then there are additional engines which get connected. At present, two engines in front and three engines at the back. Because the train has to climb up. It has to climb up till Castle Rock. So at Collin, these engines get connected. Five engines. And this whole huge coal-ridden train with 59 wagons full of coal, thousands and thousands of tons of coal. So the train can't climb up. So it requires additional power. Now, presently, the engines are driven by diesel. And further, there's next slide is about railways. If you click on that hyperlink, there's a hyperlink on the same slide where the Union Railway Minister, Mr. Piyush Goyal, who is also a Don Boscoite. I don't know if the youth are aware, Mr. Piyush Goyal is from Don Bosco Matunga. And he is on record saying that we will not use the diesel engines, we will be using power. And that solves the mystery why 400 kV line is coming to Kole. It is not for you and me, for the people and for the domestic users. It is to power this engine. And yes, some of it will also be taken out of Goa to some other places. So what I want to say is, why is the government lying to its people? It's our government. We have been taught of the people, for the people, by the people. Then why these lies? Is it because you all are trying to help some industrialist? Fine, you help. But why? At what cost? You are destroying our forest, our wildlife, our national parks, our biodiversity, the Western Ghats, which is a protecting wall for us. So I'm sure the youth are now able to connect that the coal is going to come into Marmogwa, go by double track, it's going to go by roads, what they are saying, expansion of national highways, because the road is going, now presently coal is going by road. It starts from Marmogwa, and you all know where the airport road is. From the airport road, it goes to the Verna Junction. At Verna Junction, it turns right, and it goes, takes the Margao road, and at Nuve, where the Kinetic Honda or some that showroom is there, it takes a left in that bypass when you go towards the Chogole College. So you go that side, and there is that Arlem Circle, which is there near the Pepsi company. There it takes a turn, goes to the Boring Bridge, connects on, gets on to National Highway 566. Then it gets into National Highway 768. From there, the Panjim Belagavi Road, and it is into Karnataka. So it finally, the coal is going to these companies based in Karnataka. Same way, the railway, the double tracking, these are all going. Kole, you get these five engines to power the train to go up to Castle Rock, and the train is into Karnataka to feed the coal to these companies. And the third is the rivers. The three rivers we have already identified, Kumarjua, number 27, Mandovi, number 68, and Zuari, number 111. So it will go, get unloaded at the jetties, be loaded onto the trucks, and then it will go by the highways, cross the ghats and get into Karnataka. So this is how I think so we have uncovered the entire mystery. What happens to why are we opposing? One is the destruction of the forest. Second is, as I said, it's a beautiful land. It is to be known in Konkani. I've heard from my childhood, Neketra Udentiche, a star of the east, Rome of the east. These are beautiful names given, how we have given, we have given titles to Mother Mary. That way some of the poets and singers, theatrists gave names to this beautiful land. They believed it is a gift of God. So we have got all these beaches for which, and the beautiful environment and forest for which all the foreign tourists come into Goa to enjoy, to feel this beauty, natural beauty. And once this coal dust flies all over, because the scientists have said when a train moves at over 100 kilometers an hour, the coal dust flies anywhere between 5 kilometers to 15 kilometers. So there will be coal dust because, you know, the density of the coal dust is very low. So it flies with the speeds. And from where the winds come, this is, again, science. You know, you all know we get the rains. We get the southwesterly winds. From where does the winds originate? It originates all the way in Persia, somewhere in Iran. It comes over Afghanistan, goes over Pakistan, comes to the Arabian Sea, picks up the water vapors, goes, hits the Ghats. There's precipitation, and that's how we get plenty of rains. So these southwesterly winds which are there are also going to blow the coal dust all over Goa. And this beautiful gift of Goa, this beautiful land, is going to be covered with a lot of dust, coal dust. Tourists are not going to come to Goa. There will be health problems going to affect our lungs. You also saw what happened during the COVID lockdown in Vasco. Over 55% of the deaths that happened in Goa happened in Vasco. Why? Because they have been breathing coal dust every day, 24/7. The immunity of these people have gone down. A 14-year-old girl died. You know, a counselor died. So many people died in Vasco because the lungs, the inner lining, there is a coating of coal dust. And we had written to the chief minister, please do some research. Don't make it political. Make it for Goa. And this research, the results of it will help the whole world, that what happens when people knowingly, unknowingly inhale the coal dust. You know, you get cancer, you get stroke, because see, when we breathe the oxygen, it goes through our nostrils into the lungs. That's where the oxygen gets mixed with the blood. And Allah, if we have oxygen mixed with coal dust 24/7, it will get mixed in the blood. It will go to the brain, all parts of the body. And especially it is dangerous for expectant mothers. You know, the fetus is just forming. In the womb, the baby inside will get affected. We will get, you know, we won't get healthy babies. They'll be deformed in various forms. It'll harm their brains. You know, they're very delicate organs inside which are developing. So imagine so many health hazards are there. We are going to, you know, after the mining industry was closed down, banned in 2012, only the tourism industry is there. Lakhs and lakhs of people are dependent, be it the shacks, be it the hotels, lodges. There are houses, Goans rent rooms to tourists. You know, they earn their living in whatever form. And then the taxi drivers, the pilots, motorcycle pilots, all of them are going to lose. They're going to become jobless. So what a disaster in the making is awaiting us. So we have been requesting the government. We have been trying to impress. What are you doing? We have elected you to save Goa, to improve Goa. If you cannot improve, just leave us alone. You know, we want to hand over Goa, whatever is remaining, to the youth. You know, we want the youth. We want you to enjoy. All my friends today on the webinar, I want to tell you, this thing is for you all. When we pray, when we do all these things, it is to save our land for you all. I have had a good life. When I say good life, a good Goa. And I give all the gratitude to my parents, to the elders, to my friends, all the elderly people who must have passed away also. They saved Goa, you know. So I hope all of you, my friends, understand what this fight is about. And a fight is going to be more effective, more focused, and more decisive if all of you join us. Because this fight is not for me and people of my age. I'm already 50. And I think so. I'm past my prime. But I want to fight because on my deathbed, I don't want my child to ask me, Daddy, what were you doing when Goa was getting destroyed? I cannot say, Maka kidak polla. I can't say I got scared. I can't say, you know, I was sitting because I was scared that the cops may arrest me. So that day when the call was given to Shandor, it's far away. I had never gone to Shandor. And when that call was given in the night, I rushed there with my friends. We spent the whole night. It was a very peaceful vigil. We kept vigil with candles on. Many of you must have been there. And there are cases filed against us saying that there was rioting. There was damaged property. Believe me, even today if you go, there are videos you can watch. It was, we enjoyed. We sang hymns. We sang patriotic songs, you know. And these are the false cases. So the cases filed by people whom we have elected, cases filed by police who get their salary from our taxpayers' money. I mean, they are under pressure. But I come to the end of my talk. I hope I have been able to convey certain things. There is much more to be told. But I think so for the time being, this is enough. You all have understood how coal is going to come. And at the end of it, one small point I missed out and I want to tell. It is there in the show, in the PowerPoint presentation, where why it is coming to Goa? Are there no alternate routes? No, there are routes. Goa is going to become the alternate route. Because now, for example, there is coal coming to these companies from Orissa and Jharkhand. It comes to the port Paradip, which is there in Orissa, or Haldia Investment. It comes to those ports, you know. And from there now, what is the plan is, it is being brought all the way by sea down the peninsula of India. It goes up and it is unloaded at MPT. And that is why from there they want to take by railway. That is the double track. Now, why? Because presently, the present route is only to go by rail. So this company, consulted company, found that if it goes by rail, the charges are 2,298 per ton. That is the freight charge, the transportation charge. The technical term is freight charge. But if they bring the cargo, the coal, by rail up till these ports in Orissa and West Bengal, and then they bring it down by sea, by ship, to MPT, and then take it by double tracking, they will save 48 rupees. The freight charge will come down to 2,250. So you will say, my friends, only for 48 rupees, so much of destruction of Goa by this rich man called Adani? No, my friends. Try to recollect. I told you it is 136 million tons per year of coal that is going to come. So 136 into, when you say 1 million, it is 10 lakhs. So 136 into 10 lakhs into a ton. One ton is 1,000 kgs. Okay, into 48 rupees saving if it comes by Marmogao. So you all have got mobiles with you. If you put on your calculator and check, you will not be able to get that figure. It's a huge figure, and that is a saving. It's a profit for Adani. And for that, all this infrastructure is being built by destroying Goa. And this infrastructure is being built at what cost? Whose money? It's your and my money. Some of the youth may say, I don't pay tax. My friend, you're sorry to know that when you buy a mobile, you're paying tax. You're buying shoes, you pay tax. You go to a restaurant, have a cup of tea. I mean, you all have now all that coffee cafe day and all those things. You pay tax. This tax goes, and this tax is being used to build infrastructure to benefit this industrialist, which is going to destroy Goa. I think so. I've finished. Thank you. Any questions?
Olsen?
Do you guys have any questions? I can type in the chat box.
There are already some questions that are in the chat box.
Can ask Captain to chat box? You can type in a question in the chat box.
Okay.
Captain, I think we had one question from Nitesh, but it isn't a bit clear. Nitesh, could you maybe just clarify the question so we know what exactly you're talking about? Could you retype it in the chat box? The question pertains to, so you already know who it is. Could you just rephrase that? Or maybe come unmute your audio and come online?
Nitesh Borkar. I think so. Yeah. His question is, so you already know who it is. That's the question?
Yeah, that's the question.
I have not been able to understand what he wants to know. So you
No, he's
going to type it.
He'll retype it.
Yeah.
In the meanwhile, can we take the question from Wayne? Wayne Dias asks, yes. how much land is required for the substation?
You don't require much land. You don't require substation. It depends upon the capacity.
Did they specify something?
Yeah, our team has got the documents. Based on RPI, we have managed to get the documents. The question is not how much land is required to build the substation. That is not important. We are saying we don't want the substation because of that substation, you're bringing the 400 kV line through forest, destroying the biodiversity, destroying the flora, fauna, the whole lot of our biodiversity.
Yeah, because...
The substation is something like, you know, you're building a road through villages and villages, and then you're building a house in 100 square meters. That building house in 100 square meters is not important. But to build that road through villages, you're destroying so many houses, you're cutting so many trees, thousands of trees. That is what we don't want.
Yeah, I have been to the site on Friday. I have been there.
So you know the reality.
Yeah, I know the place. So, and I have seen that they have grown plants on rocky land.
And the distance
between the plant is not even 1 meter.
No, Wayne, that is not important. Now what you are saying, 1 meter and all, that is for you and me. It's for the people. They want to showcase, oh, we are environmental friendly. And, you know, though we are cutting thousands and thousands of trees, but see here, we are planting trees. And they will plant trees for photo ops. And once we move from here, nobody will be there to water the plants, and they're going to die. This is what people, a lot of organizations in Goa do during the Vano Mahotsav in June. You know, when the politicians, they plant trees, photo ops, and they go. And there's nobody to nurture the plants after that.
Yeah, because when I was studying my diploma, and we were like taught about gas insulated substations.
Yeah.
So for that, the land required was just around 500 square meter. But when you are using an air insulated substation, they require around 47,000 square meter land. And suppose in case if there are any sparks and all from the wires and all, then full forest may get damaged.
No, that is one part where there have been forest fires. But there is another thing which the scientists have said that when these high tension lines are going, with such high power lines, there is radiation which is affecting the people. And I heard a priest telling me, who was based in Bangalore, that the Father Gudino from Morli, he was there in Bangalore for a little while. And during that time, they used to stay, all the priests were there. He said a new priest came, and within few months, he was getting affected. They didn't know how. They couldn't make sense of it. So they shifted him away from there. And then another priest came there. He also started behaving in this particular manner. And then they realized there is this radiation which is happening from these lines, which is directly affecting. So they came to know by chance because they became inquisitive. But this is happening all over the world. It's affecting the trees, the plants. There's radiation happening. But the government will not declare that because it is going to affect their plans, which have been made by crony capitalists. Yeah.
Thank you, Wayne, for that, and thank you, Captain Viriyat, for answering so clearly. The next question we have is from Nitesh Borkar. He says, Captain Viriyat, you mentioned that you know who is the official at the highest level who authorized this project, and you will expose this person at the right time. When and what is the right time? And do you have evidence to prove who it is, and how sure are you that you know that it is this person? The question is in the chat, Captain.
See, Nitesh, it's when it comes to a government, it is not a person. It's a government. It's probably a party which becomes, trying to favor some certain industrialist. Now, if you recollect, during the UPA time, when the Congress was in power, there were allegations that they were trying to help certain industrialists, you know, and those industrialists were, for example, the coal controversy started that time, you know, that they had given coal mines on lease to certain of their favored companies. The same thing happened in the telecom scam, that they had given the bandwidth for starting these service providers, you know. There were cases filed in the Supreme Court. A lot of people who were this. Now, in the present scenario, we are seeing that the present government at the center is favorable to Adani and his companies. And yesterday, he has come on record. He has come on record. He's released a statement that I am transferring only so much of coal. Why are you all blaming me? But we are talking about he has bought a coal mine. He traveled with Prime Minister to Australia. You know, there's documentary evidence. The newspapers had published it. And that is there in my presentation. If you see the photograph, it's right in the beginning that he travels. He met the Prime Minister of Australia. And then the fight is still going on in Australia. People are still protesting. He has already bought the mine. He's invested $2 billion. And he's going to start the mine. So this is in public domain. But certain documents which are there, which establish the direct link, that we will be bringing out at the right time. The right time is the strategic time. You know, if I tell you, it is like telling the government. You know, so strategies and exposures are what finally helps in winning the battle against the destruction.
Captain, the next question is from Bonita Dias. She asks, what about the existing railway line? Why can't it be optimally utilized, taking extra precautions? For example, there could be a subway or an overhead road bridge to avoid disruption of traffic.
Bonita, you mean to say the rail can be used in whatever way you are, by building a subway, you're saying to transport the coal?
Yeah, Captain. See, I live in Kansaulin, so we have the railway line. So right now the protests are for double tracking. Okay, so keeping that in mind, I mean, we have this goods train transporting coal, but then it's not throughout the day. It's most active, I think, during the night. How about during the day? I mean, can't they like utilize it optimally instead of going for a double track?
Absolutely. Now, what you're talking is about optimal use of coal. I'm talking about optimal use of passengers. Now, for a better understanding, I will tell you, there is the Konkan Railway, correct? There's a Konkan Railway, which is going
exactly
from Margaon to Bombay and all. For a better understanding, I'm telling you, for appreciation, there's only a single track, Konkan Railway, single track. And there are 17 trains which go by every day, including the Rajdhani, Shatabdi, Netravati, Mandivi. Name the trains and they're all moving every day, 24/7, plus the goods train. So many, 17 plus goods trains are traveling on that single track. Now from Vasco when it goes towards Karnataka.
Correct.
Let us say to Castle Rock and Londa. Now, as per the figures, it's there in my presentation, the slide is there. There are only 5 trains which are going, the total number of trains in 1 week, not even every day. Now, the Kule Express, Kule local train, that is the 3 compartments, the one train goes from Vasco to Kule every day, taking the locals, those who want to go to work. But most of it gets, they get down at Margao. You know, now that comes back in the evening with the people returning back after work. Now that train has stopped since COVID time from 25th March, I think. So after that, it stopped. It's not yet resumed. So that's one train which is to go. The other train which go just once a week, that is twice a week, Saturday and Monday, that is Yashwantpur Express. That is close to Bangalore. And all the people who are going, they miss the direct train to Divine Center. They take the Yashwantpur Express. And Yashwantpur, they change the train and they go to the Divine Center. Same way, the Chennai Express, there's only one train in a week, that is Thursday. People who go to Valankani, they want to go to Chennai, they take that train. Then there is one Amravati Express. And finally, another train, which is the Goa Express, which is also known as the Nizamuddin Express. This goes every day. That means the only train which goes every day. So there are 5 trains in the entire week. You know, rest of the trains are for coal. So it is like saying, now you are in Kansauli. You want to go from Kansauli to Margao. You've got a family, say, of 4 people. And then you've got friends coming over. You all are total 7 people. You know, and then you'll say in your car, there are only 4 people can fit to go to Margao. So what do you do about the 3 people? Oh, let us build another road. The government is saying, let us build another road to take you to Margao. Sorry, we are saying if 4 people, only 4 people are fitting in the car, we'll get another car or we'll bring a bigger car and all 7 will go together. Now here what the government is saying is, it is meant for passengers. It will benefit the passengers. So we are putting one more track. Like only 4 people are fitting in the car, so we'll build one more road instead of taking a bigger car. So here, if you want to help the people, you put more compartments at the back or you start more trains because there are only 5 trains in the entire week. Whole day, there are no passenger trains in Kansauli. From your home, you'll be able to appreciate. There are no passenger trains, hardly any train. The rest are all good train and the coal train. And why they're moving in the night, there's a reason for that. That is how the operations in MPT is happening. They don't want to alarm the people. That is only now to about 12 million tons per year. With that, the trains are moving in the night. What about 136 million tons? Imagine how many, 10, 12 times more can they travel in the night? They'll travel 24/7. You will not get rest. Your houses, everything, your kitchen, drawing room will be full of coal dust. I hope I have been able to explain.
Thank you, Bonita, for the question.
Thank you, Captain.
We'll take the final question for today because I think the questions by Brother Infancio and Esther, the questions will be answered by Valerie and Sherry because Sherry is specifically into online activities. So the last question is by Clint George. What are the steps to be taken moving forward?
First of all, we have said is we want to stop the destruction. So how do we stop? They have started this process of land acquisition. Land acquisition means all these properties which are there on which the existing houses are there of people, they are going to acquire. And once they are acquired, they are going to demolish the houses. There are some which are centuries old houses. Where are these people going to go? Now the railways is saying we are going to give you money. You know, that is not the answer. You're going to destroy the houses, you're going to destroy the life, and then you're going to transport coal, you're going to destroy the life of all the villagers, whole of Goa. So we are saying, we have told the government, we've given the memorandum, said first stop land acquisition. Secondly, why MPT? You want to take the coal into Karnataka? There are ports in Karnataka. There is Bellakiri port, which is very close to all these companies which require coal. Bellakiri port. Then there is Karwar port. There is Mangalore port. So why are you bringing to MPT? Because Goa is a very small, you know, it's like a dot on the map. Even the Sindhudurg district is much bigger than Goa put all together. So leave us alone. The only thing we survive is on tourism nowadays. They're going to destroy tourism to meet the requirement, to satisfy the coal requirement of companies based in Karnataka. You know, we don't have anything against Karnataka. I mean, it's a different thing that Madai has been also made a U-turn. It's been blocked. By the way, I want to tell the youth, Madai has been turned and taken inside. And as per our research team, it is to meet the requirement of farmers who are growing the sugar crop, because sugar crop is a water guzzling crop, and also to meet the requirement of all the steel companies, because they require a lot of water. So I just slightly diverted bringing Mother inside, but these are the when you say the step, stop land acquisition, we are giving you alternate routes, alternate ports, leave Goa alone.
Thank you, Captain. We have one final question. We decided to ask this question because it's a very good question. This is a question by Regan Fernandez. He says, good day, Captain. Good day, our environment minister in his recent interview with Faye D'Souza, have said that all these projects of the double track, power line, etc. are for the benefit of people, and very soon we will get a written assurance from the central government that there won't be any increase in coal transportation in Goa. What would you say about that? Will it be done?
You know, Regan, and all the youth, I want to tell you that even the chief minister a couple of days back said, double tracking will come, but coal will not come. And to simplify, I'll give you an analogy. It's like saying that Nilesh Kabral and chief minister saying, we will allow the terrorists to pass through Goa, but we will not allow the terrorists to kill the people of Goa. It is something like that. You will build a road, a double track for whom? To transport the coal. You've got a track which you are not using it. Only 5 trains in a week, not even in a day. 5 trains in the entire week. You cannot use. Start more trains if it's for the benefit of the people. Start moving more goods train. You are bringing containers all the way by road. There's more pollution. Bring the containers by sea to MPT. Load them onto the trains and take it by this track, the existing track. If one track of Konkan Railway can cater to 17 major trains crisscrossing the country right from Trivandrum through Margao and going all the way to Bombay and Delhi and all, why can't you use this track? Well, you're using it 5 trains in a week, hardly one train in a day. So Mr. Nilesh Kabral is under tremendous pressure, you know, sad to say that the BJP is using this man because of his whatever faith background to be the altar boy, to put this thing, see, I'm the man, believe me, I'm one of you, allow the tracks to come, it's not going to bring coal, and who is going to give in writing, as per our research, you know, I don't want to put allegations, probably Nilesh Kabral has got a lot to answer. He must have been caught in his own web by the BJP government, and they're saying, you do this dirty work, otherwise we will expose you. So this is how political parties work across, whether it's the BJP, Congress, whatever. But Congress, what happens is, when the people protest, they go on the back foot. The BJP is steamrolling. So we want the BJP to listen to us. We are your people. You are our government. Listen to us. We don't belong to any foreign country. You know. So when Nilesh Kabral, you all saw how he was answering the interview with Ms. Faye, I felt very sorry that one of our ministers cut a sorry figure. He couldn't answer. He just couldn't answer.
Thank you, Captain, for all those all the answers that you've given to all the questions raised. And thank you, everyone, for all those insightful questions. For those who we couldn't get Captain to answer them, we'll forward them to Captain Viryat and get back to you.
Sure.
And we thank you, Captain Viryat, for that inspiring and very informative talk.
My pleasure.
All of us have understood the facts behind the key issues threatening Goa. And another note, if any of you all would like access to the PowerPoint and documents, please comment in the chat with your email ID and we will send them across to you. And thank you once again, Captain Viryat, for taking the time to share your knowledge with us.
Thank you. My pleasure. Thank you. Yeah. God bless you.
Thanks, Captain.
Okay, now we have our next speaker, Valerie Alfonso, and I request Yuan Gudino to give a short introduction and welcome the speaker.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. Our next speaker is Ms. Valerie Alfonso. She is a MA student in Goa University, and she also is the president of the Chikalim Youth Farmers Club. She has represented the state of Goa nationally in the sport of rugby on multiple occasions. She is also the member of the Village Development Committee. Valerie, you may now begin speaking. Thank you.
We
Valerie, your mic is not clear. Can you check your mic if you don't mind? Thank you. No, we can't hear it. Okay.
Otherwise, you can invite Sherry to speak. There's no problem.
Yeah.
Hello, Sherry. Are you?
Yes, I'm here.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So, guys, we'll have Sherry to speak before Valerie. Then. So Sherry Fernandez is a journalism graduate from Goa University. She currently works as a freelancer for the Goa Times of India. She is also an environmental activist and works for the conservation and protection of animals and wildlife of all kinds. Sherry, we welcome you. Now you may begin.
I just wanted to thank Captain Virat firstly for giving us such an insightful session, because a lot of points over there were really important, and they helped us with a lot more clarity than the government has ever given us on the day. And also, like he has rightfully said, the government has been lying to us. There's no doubt about that. Mr. Cabral Nilesh has been lying to us. And like Captain Virat also said, you know, it doesn't take them too long to immediately take a U-turn and go back to their words and basically continue lying to all of us. And even as someone pointed out that in the talk with Faye D'Souza, he couldn't answer anything. He had no straight answer to any question that was put forward. He did not have any answer to any question that was put forward. And he kept dodging all the questions. I mean, at one point, Faye D'Souza spoke about people getting arrested and the FIR being filed against the protesters, he spoke about, and I quote, he said that getting arrested is a part of democracy. I mean, what? How is getting arrested a part of democracy when people right there are actually voicing out their concerns about these projects happening over there? And then there was another, I wanted to clarify one more thing, that there were a lot of people that said that, you know, there were people who came with the Congress flags and all of that. Please remember that most of us, I mean, all of us there, we are not affiliated. So I am not politically affiliated with anything. I was there because I was upset about what is happening, and so should all of y'all. All 65 of y'all that are here joined today, all of y'all should be upset about what is happening today. That your government, the people that you elected, the people that you all that are supposed to be representing you, representing all the problems you face, they are the ones that have been lying to you. Either they have been lying to you or they refuse to represent you. So I wanted to point out a few initiatives that have been taken by the students right from June. You know, that it's not like the students and the youth have only started now. People, children have been speaking about this since June, but only we had traction now because of the efforts of all of these kids and all of these youth people who started have been working relentlessly since June. This is only why today a lot of people have been talking about it all over India. So a few initiatives that were taken by the students, firstly is like Knee for Moller. You would find children kneeling down in front of their favorite tree with a poster that says, you know, raise our questions, raise the questions that we have. And this was a message to their MLAs. We also had students go to the MLAs in their offices during the pandemic. They took the risks. They went to the MLAs and they gave them a physical letter. So tomorrow, you know, like how Mr. Prakash Javedekar said, he didn't receive anything above from us. I mean, leave that entirely aside. But this is why students went. They gave physical letters to their representatives asking them to raise their questions. They have printed out everything, all the questions that they would need, and they asked their representatives. Some of them have some of them put forward, they have written letters, like Mrs. Alina Saldana has written twice, and she's a member of the BJP party itself. She has written twice about all of these projects and how they're going to destroy livelihoods. So right from Nifa Mole, when students were tweeting a lot, you know, those who have not even had accounts, even from the 65 of y'all, if y'all do not have Twitter accounts today, please take out the time, take out, it takes 2 minutes to make an account, honestly. Take out the time, make a Twitter account, start following Save Mole Goa, and start tweeting about everything. Twitter is a very official place. So the people you tag over there, it basically shows the rest of the people that are going to see your retweets and stuff about how or what is currently your issue. So get a Twitter account, start retweeting, start tweeting, start tagging people, celebrities, start tagging journalists, start tagging influencers, not just national, not just from India, but on a global spectrum as well. Have them look at what is happening in Goa today, because now, despite the people of Goa speaking so much about this since June, the government has only started reacting now to an extent where, you know, you can make out that they have no answers. And this is only because it's gone on to national media. Okay, because even on Faye D'Souza's talk, the first time when Faye D'Souza and her team had approached Mr. Nilesh Cabral, he chickened out. He point blank chickened out. The second time also, he did not pick up the call. And then finally, the third time, when students got fed up about the government refusing to answer questions, they made memes on it. This is their way of basically showing that, you know, we're sick of this. They made memes of how he has been chickening out all this while. And then he went on to the talk. He spoke absolute rubbish. None of his questions, none of his answers were on point. None of them answered anything about what we really wanted to ask. So this is what I want to tell. That, you know, you have to make a Twitter account, start tweeting, start retweeting, start using your social media platforms, whether you have 100 followers or 1,000, it is not less. Even out of the 100 followers, if 5 people start paying attention to what you have to say about what is happening, it is a huge deal. So start talking about it and start tagging people. There are toolkits also made by a lot of youth, you know, there have been toolkits made that is here to help you onboard onto the issue. So there are 2 citizen toolkits that will tell you whom to tag, what you can retweet. It gives you information about press releases. It tells you about what has been going on right from the beginning. So even if you are not very familiar about what is happening, like most of us are every day, you know, each day that I read about this, I find something new. So there's never enough information that you can all learn. So even if you're not very familiar about what is happening, start reading these toolkits. I'd be very happy if you all give your emails, we will try and send them across to you also. But start reading, get informed, so that tomorrow if someone has a question, you know how to answer it. Because I'll be very honest, it is not easy being in this aspect. There are a lot of trolls. You'll get trolled a lot if you keep talking about this. The BJP IT cell and all these guys, they keep trolling you. They'll make posters and stuff. But do not let that hinder your spirit. You have to keep talking about this, whether what party you support, keep that aside. Because today, I have been traveling. I used to go to Mollem to trek a lot, and I can tell you there are so many amazing creatures in that forest. I've seen my first hump-nosed pit viper over there. It's a beautiful snake. And the fact that this government refuses to acknowledge all of this, and it has not even taken them time. For example, the EIA report, it's an environment impact assessment report, which basically studies about how these projects are going to impact the environment over there. It is not yet put out in public. So that is another thing. You need to keep asking your representatives, ask your government about why these documents have not been put across to you. Like Captain Virat said. He said that all these documents have been missing from public domain. Even the white paper that tells you about power consumption is not put across. Tag Mr. Nilesh Cabral. Tell him, what is he doing? Why is he not giving us the documents that we need? Tell him that, you know, they probably think that you and I are incapable of understanding these things. Tell him to put it across. Tell him that we are not stupid, your voters are not stupid, and that he needs to start putting out documents and start being clear with us. They need to provide clarity with us. Sorry, clarity to us. So these are the ways. These are just few of the many ways. You can even volunteer your writing. You can volunteer your skills, whether you're good at writing, whether you're good at speaking. You should come forward, start talking about these issues, start talking to the people, and volunteer your time, volunteer your skills, because this movement needs a lot of people to speak up. If today all 70 of y'all that have joined here, if today all of y'all just start tweeting, imagine 70 people tweeting at one minister and asking him, what are you doing? Why are you sleeping? Why are you not responding to what we have, the questions that we have? It creates a storm. It creates enough of a storm where, you know, the media will want to cover it. So the media also is very selective about the news they pick up. They only want to cover things that, you know, have been in the news for a while or has been creating a stir, sort of a storm, sort of in a way. So if you all start talking about this, start tagging the ones that, you know, should be held accountable, if you all start tweeting about it and start spreading more news about what is happening, it forces the media, whether they want to cover this or not, because trust me, a lot of media houses, when they see the names of Jindal or Adani, they immediately back out. They don't want to really cover anything negative about these companies, because in the end, it all depends on advertising and the revenue that they generate and stuff like that. But if all of y'all keep talking, it forces them to cover. Because when there is a storm happening right there, the media cannot ignore it, because then the rest of the other people will question their ethics. So you have to keep trying to have your media cover you. Then besides that, there has been a lot of... with regards to clarity, I think actually Mr. Captain Viriyath has covered a lot of things. So in terms of how these three projects are going to be really destructive, I think it's all covered. There's nothing more that I could probably say in that aspect. But in terms of what you can do, it is important that you really speak up about this, that you need to stop seeing yourself as, you know, I'm just a youngster. There's nothing I can say or do that these elected representatives might want to listen to. It's rubbish. All of them need to be held accountable by people like you and me. Because when we speak up, it makes the rest of the world, actually right now it's the rest of the world. We have people from Africa also, people from all over, people from Germany. There have been people from all across the globe who have been standing in support for Molem. Only because the youth have been continuously talking about it and tagging people, right from FFF India. And another thing that I think is very important for all of you to know is that you have to sign petitions. So if you join on to Let India Breathe, Let India Breathe is a platform where, you know, you can send your emails via them. And there have been, I think, 3,33,000 so far emails being sent, because despite thousands of emails and so many representations being sent by students, lawyers, architects, teachers, tourism stakeholders, Mr. Prakash Javedkar came here and said that he didn't get anything. So, you know, the fact that they've been blatantly denying and lying to you should get you upset. It should piss you off that the people that are supposed to be here wanting to look after the resources. So, I want you all to know that all these resources, you know, your forests, your rivers, your land, all of these places, it's basically owned by the state on behalf of people like you and I. It has been owned, it is owned by the state so that they can look after it on behalf of us in the public trust doctrine. As per it, these guys should be held accountable because they have not been doing what you and I expect them to do. They're supposed to be protecting our forest. See, I'm all for development. You know, a lot of trolls, they keep tagging people from the Molem campaign. They keep tagging people who speak up for the destruction that's happening, saying that, oh, you don't use electricity. You don't use electricity at home. Don't you need it? We all need electricity. But my question is, why does Mr. Nilesh Kabral have to lie to all of us in order to get this done? He has been changing his numbers like anything, like Captain Virat said. Last year, he said that Goa was, you know, self, like we were sufficient and we did not need more power and stuff like that. When there were cutouts happening in the south, he said that all of that will be solved and we don't need anything. Then suddenly this year, he changed his mind. I mean, why has he been lying to all of us? Even in the press release by Goyan Kalsanaka, it clearly shows the numbers as per the Goa Statistical Handbook. that Mr. Nilesh Kabra has been lying to all of us, and we do not want these kind of leaders. We need to let them know that if they continue doing the things that they are doing today, the ways that they have been following this, we are not going to want them in the future. We are not going to want them in 2022. We need to let them know that tomorrow people like you and I will not vote for them. We do not want leaders like that who have been lying to the people over here, because that is not what we deserve. So it is important that you keep tagging. I mean, even if you at some point feel like, you know, your messages are not going through, it doesn't matter. Just keep tagging these guys. Keep tagging media houses along with them. Keep asking questions. There are so many questions for people like you and I to ask these representatives, you know, right from, like, now also a few MLAs have joined the bandwagon of speaking up against Smollett, because they know that if they don't, in the future, we're going to remember it and we're not going to vote for them. And that is the only reason that they have started joining the campaign. At least that is what I feel, because so long since June, people like you and I have been questioning them and there was no response. So suddenly now they've decided that they want to speak against the destruction. Why? Because they know that you and I are the people who can put them into power or take them off. So it is important that all of y'all get together, you'll join the campaign and you'll start speaking up about it. Just, you know, viewing webinars and sitting and thinking that, you know, okay, if I just, you know, keep reading and all, it's just not enough anymore. Just staying informed is not enough. You have to act on that information. The information that you get, the information that you read, you must act upon it so that we can all hold these guys accountable, because they probably think that you're going to get away with it, and they need to be reminded that you're not going to get away with it. And you should be upset about this, because tomorrow it is going to affect. I live in Vasco. I have breathing issues. My family, my family also has breathing issues. Since my childhood, I've been going to the hospital using a nebulizer sometimes in the night as well. Because the people of Vasco, like even Captain Viriyak again, he said people of Vasco have been so badly affected. You can imagine how the rest of Goa is going to be affected by this. And the fact that they're saying now that coal is not going to come through, they think we're big fools, and we need to show them that we are not fools anymore. We are not going to listen to the claims that they make, because, you know, they keep changing their words. If suppose today they feel like, oh, we won't let the destruction happen, suddenly tomorrow they're like, oh, but coal has to pass. So it is important that all of you speak up, all of you get upset about this. You'll have to be super upset about this, because I'm telling you, tomorrow, if any of you all have been to the forest of Molle, if you all have been over here, you all will know what I'm talking about. It is such an amazing place. Transmission lines are there, the transmission line that is to be erected over there is just going to ruin that place up. And it's going to put over their documentation. Provide us with the clarity that is going to provide us with the clarity about the number of people that is going to be prepared. Ask them to be more disturbance. Yeah, ask them to be more upfront about what is happening and act for it. Don't be scared to hold them accountable. I know that a lot of our parents are not completely supportive about the things they are doing. Like, I can tell you that.
Just 1 second. Well, Sherry, Vishnu, can you just. Okay, yeah, cool. You can continue.
So I know that a lot of our families will not be up for, like, you know, letting us go to protest, letting us be a part of all these gatherings, or, you know, they might be scared about how you're voicing out your concerns about all of this, and they might be scared that tomorrow you might get arrested. Just honestly, we've reached a point where we cannot be scared about that anymore. If you are 18 above and if you have the capability of thinking for yourself, you need to start thinking. You need to leave all of that aside, like I have left it all aside. And I have put my heart into thinking that, you know, these forests are really important for us. I've spent my younger years over there. I know how important and how beautiful that place is above all. Yeah, that those the creatures that are there, they're endemic species. So many of them are endemic species. You won't find them anywhere else in the world. And they're found here in Goa, in such a small state. Another thing that I remember right now is that, you know, even when Miss Nandini Velio was talking about the biodiversity on Face Talk, she mentioned one aspect about the EIA report, you know, which tells us that either the EIA report is absolute bullshit, sorry for my language, or the EIA report is actually good to an extent that shows the diversity in Goa. For example, in the EIA report of the railway, tells you how the environment is going to be impacted over there by the railway, by the railway being there. And over there it states that 13 species of plants that are there, that have been reported in that EIA report over there, 13 species of these plants have been mentioned in this report. And as per the research that has been done, these 13 species have never ever been found in Goa before that report. Before that report came out, these 13 species were never found in Goa. So either the EIA report is absolute crap, that, you know, it's either crap, they've been just putting random things there, or the EIA report is so good that it show, like, in that aspect, it just tells you that, you know, there is so much about Goa's biodiversity that still needs to be learned. There have been so many, like, I know that a species was discovered by Mr. Parag Ravnikar. It was described to science from there. There have been so many species that have been described to science from Goa itself, from those areas. And it is so important, if you know what, if possible, tweet about this, tweet about all these shortcomings, and tag your ministers, tag your MLAs, and tell them, you know what, if you do not see the beauty that lies in these forests, the creatures that thrive over there, let us take you, let us show you these forests, let us take you for a trek over there, and let us show you what exactly lives and thrives in these forests, that, you know, you'll don't even take minutes to think, like, these ministers don't even take minutes to think about the destruction that you're going to cause over there. It takes us longer to make a cup of noodles than it takes them to, you know, just sign these clearances so that the rest of Goa is just obliterated. So you'll need to hold all of these guys responsible, and don't be scared about doing it. Don't be scared about what are the consequences. As long as you're respectful, as long as you're speaking the truth, you need to start holding all these guys accountable. Have them answer your questions. If they can't answer your questions, then come out again and say that, you know, the people I've elected today are just not capable about answering my questions. So why would I want to elect them again in 2022? Hold Pramod Sawant accountable as well. You need to ask your chief minister why he's not listening to any of us. Why he's... I can't even begin to tell you the stuff that Pramod Sawant has been saying. We need to have a discussion with all of these representatives. We need to have them all on one panel as electors, as people that have elected them. We need to have all of these guys on a panel, and we need to put forth our questions across to them, and we need them to answer us. All of them should be together, and we need all of them to answer us. So you should keep tagging them, keep tagging journalists that you admire, you know, people like Faye D'Souza, even though it's still out there now. A lot of mainstream media is not covering it. Tag them. Tag all of these journalists and ask them why, what it's going to take until, you know, they start reporting about what is happening in Goa and how the people of Goa are suffering. Because it is scary that so many of us have to risk our lives just so that the government pays attention to its voters. It should not be like this. People like you and I are not supposed to put our lives on the line, our families' lives on the line, just so that our government can pay attention to us. We have voted them for a reason, and they're supposed to listen to us, and they're supposed to put forward our questions, which they're not doing. So hold them accountable and don't be scared to do that. That's actually all I wanted to put forward.
Thank you, Sherry, for that insightful and very informative talk. I'd like to call Johan to introduce our next speaker.
Yeah. Our next speaker is Miss Valerie Afonso. She is a MA student in Goa University, and she is also the president of the Chikalim Youth Farmers Club. She has represented the state of Goa nationally in the sport of rugby on multiple occasions. She is also the member of the Village Development Committee. We welcome you, Valerie, and you may begin.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes.
Okay.
Not audible.
I've joined in from my sister's account. I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me, and it is an honor to be speaking besides Captain and Sherry. So you have heard, Captain, how all these things are going to be affecting us, how double tracking, how the transmission line, how the four laning. Sorry, I forgot to keep on my camera. How these things are going to affect us. And as Sherry has said, how online agitations work. Well, I'm a bit skeptical about online agitations because you've seen how Mr. Jawrekar has taken all these petitions. He has denied everything, but still keep going on. It is important to make people aware. It is important to spread the message globally. So that is one thing that needs to continue throughout. Then as youth, I have been, you know, participating in the events that are happening. I've been accompanying the flash mob that we are doing. You must have heard about it, the Chikalim group. We are doing that. So we are mostly pertaining ourselves, referring ourselves to the only the ground level activities which are happening. We are seeing people. It is very important to come on the ground as well. I know there is corona, but we have to take a step forward. We have to risk it. I'm not forcing anyone. I am not saying that you have to come out. But one day or the other, you will have to make a choice where either you stay back or come out. If you are scared, if you think, you know, what is going to happen by coming out on the streets, just think about the freedom fighters who fought for freedom, who fought for India's freedom. If they had to say, you know, let me just sit at home, or let me just, you know, support someone from, you know, from my level, then would we have gotten the freedom now? So think about that. What as youth we can do is inform. First, inform yourself. Know what you are fighting for. We are not blind bugs. We need to know. We need to be informed. Inform your friends. Tell them what is happening. I am 100% sure you will get some people who are blind, who are fanatics, who will not understand what you are saying, who will not even listen to you. Does not matter. Gather your friends. Ask them, tell them, inform them. First is inform. Then gather. Form your local groups. It is very important to have your own group. Form a small group. It is very effective when you are forming a group. You are more connected to the people. You have your own friends at your level. And then is the third one is act. So inform others, gather, and then act. Online petitions, yes. Tagging, yes. But when the time comes to come on the ground, you have to. We do not have a choice. If I give you an example, so the what happened at Chandor, I was not there. I was not well. But what happened was all the organizers, going to say for GKN, the assumption was that the police would, you know, lock them up or something like that. But then the crowd was not expected at all. But there was a huge crowd. There were thousands of people who were gathered, and there were youth over there. There were women over there. So was it possible for them to, you know, to lock you up, to jail you up? It was not possible. So there is strength in numbers. You need to remember that. I reiterate that there is strength in numbers. So if you want to do something, if you want to come out, do not come out alone. There is no point. You will be a fool in coming out alone. Gather your friends. Join any organization. There are talks happening. There are rallies happening. Maybe join. And one day, all the organizations are going to come together. For now, I think side by side, when you're protesting or when you're doing a awareness campaigns, there are PILs being filed. So Goa Foundation has filed a PIL in the High Court for Tanmar Sterlite for the transmission line. They have stopped the illegal working which was going on. But if you see, things are happening. So if the youth come up, if you read the read today's Herald newspaper, you see the headline saying only youth revolution can change the face of Goa. Only youth can do it. Why? Because we are the link. We are link between the elders and the younger generation who are there. So we have the energy with us. We have the time with us, if not all. But we have the energy. It is our Goa to save. If you think that, you know, if you're still not convinced by, you know, if you're not sure about how you can help, I have only two questions. I've been saying this all the time. If not you, then who? If being a Goan, you're not coming out to save Goa, who else is going to come? And if not now, then when? If you think, you know, if you're waiting for some other time to come out, then you probably won't have Goa left anymore. So that is the question I'm leaving with you. Thank you.
Okay, so now we'll have the question and answer round for Valerie and for Sherry. Thank you, Valerie, for your insightful talk. I think we had two questions previously by Brother Infancio. I'm a Goan doing my studies in Pune. How can I help in saving Goa apart from signing petitions and spreading social media posts? I think Sherry would be able to answer this question better.
What did you say his name was?
Infancio.
Infancio. Infancio, that's a lot of people ask us the same thing. So even if, no matter where you are, you know, like, I'll start off by saying this. Mr. Pramod Sawant said that all those who are protesting are protesting from outside. They're protesting from abroad. They're protesting from there. They're not Goans. So firstly, people are going to tell you that, you know, you're not in Goa, don't speak. They're going to tell you you're not staying over here. You have no right to speak. Please just keep them aside. Don't bother about what they have to say. People like that are, they don't like to see someone doing something, and they themselves won't do anything much. So in getting back to how you can help, it doesn't matter where you are from, all of these people, you know, wherever you might be from, if you're Goan and if your heart belongs here, there are so many opportunities where you can speak up. For example, if you're good at speaking, why don't you come on board and, you know, start talking to the press, start talking to webinars, start talking in live sessions where you can speak more about what is happening over here. You can be anywhere, but sitting at home, you can speak about this on platforms that will help more people realize about what is happening. So volunteer your skills is number one. Volunteer, whether you're good at speaking, you can then speak, or we can help you out. There are so many people who are willing to help you with whatever information you might need, pointers that you might need, and you know, how to put forth the ideas that you have, or the how to express yourself, basically. There is a lot of people that will help you. It's not just, you know, that we're asking for volunteers and then we leave you alone to you do your thing kind of thing. No, we are all going to help each other in terms of how to speak, how to put across your points, how to place your opinions before these people that refuse to acknowledge your existence also at some point. So you can volunteer your skills. If you're good at writing, you can write for us. We are always in lookout. Like, the Mole campaign always needs people to write, whether it's press releases or whether it is informative captions. It can be letters, you know, to put forward letters. So you can write for us, I mean, for the campaign. Then if you're a singer, why don't you write songs and why don't you sing? Get a few people together and sing. So like Valerie also mentioned, the protest, you know, where the thing was filed, the FIR was filed under the impressions of rioting. What rioting is this government talking about? Tag them, use, I mean, even it might seem that, you know, signing petitions and just tweeting about it and all is not enough, but it is. When you tag these guys, they actually start worrying. I mean, their PA is probably, you know, bombarded with all of these people tagging them. So when you tag them and ask them the tough questions, trust me, it does create and it does get them a little worried. And it is important to know that if these guys were not worried today, they would not be filing these FIRs. They would not be trolling people like you and I. They would not be doing anything. It is because they're worried today that so many of us have got together and we're speaking up against the way they are running things. That is why we are going to be trolled. We are going to be face a lot of problems. So tag them, tweet them, write about stuff. You all can even volunteer. If some of you are good with social media, come on board, message the Save Malai campaign. Come on board. You all can help with running accounts. You all can help with running awareness accounts of people on social media, help put out news, help put out captions. If you're an artist, you can design posters. Like, for example, we always need of posters about things that are going to take place. Maybe the protest, maybe a webinar, maybe something else. So you can volunteer your skills in terms of art and create posters. So there is basically whatever your skill set is, why don't you message? And maybe we can, you know, all guide you and take it forward from there about how you can volunteer your skills for the campaign. Because if you've noticed, this campaign has not been dead since June. Since June, every day there is at least one post on these social media accounts, because people like you and I have taken it up to make sure that the campaign doesn't die. It's not possible for one person to run all of this. It has to be, you have to keep changing responsibilities, you have to keep exchanging them so that the campaign keeps going on and that the fire just doesn't die after, like, you know, 1 month of constant tweeting. So if you have any sort of skills, which I'm sure all of you all do, all of us have some skill sets, right? Use it, message us, message the campaign, and maybe from there we can help think about, you know, how you can volunteer all of these skills. So whether you're in Pune, Mumbai, wherever you might be, even if you're not a goer and your family is over here or anything of that sort, it is all of your responsibilities to speak up. You don't have to just be a goer to speak about what is happening today. Because Indians were not scared to speak about the Amazon burning, right? It affects all of us. So wherever you might be, volunteer your skills, volunteer your resources, and you can help the campaign grow a lot stronger. Because on Instagram, we hit 10,000 3-4 days back. So we need to keep growing, and only then will the government sort of think about, you know, quivering in their boots. So you can volunteer in these manners, these ways.
Thank you, Sherry. Thank you very much.
Now the next question we have is, is it possible to have online question and answer meets with all the ministers, the activists together online live? Is it possible?
So, is Valerie answering this?
I think you will be better.
Okay. So, you know that to get on Faye D'Souza's talk itself, it took Mr. Cabral 3 times of requesting. First time he was requested, no show. It was supposed to be, so the first time he was requested was supposed to be with Nandini Velio, who is a scientist and has been working on this, with Claude Alvarez, with me, and with one more person. I forgot. So the first time he was asked, he was a no-show. The second time he was asked, he said yes, he's coming, and then he did not pick up the call. If you have been following Faye D'Souza on Twitter, you will see that she's tweeted over there, Mr. Cabral has not picked up my call. Which is like, you know, I mean, we understand your ministers and you all are busy and you all lead your own lives, all of us do. But when you're given such a platform to basically clear all of the doubts that the rest of the people of Goa have and have elected you to help them out with, why are you on no show? Don't you think it's a tad bit much of a risk? Don't you think that you're supposed to be a little bit more responsible in terms of that? So the second time he chickened out. And then the third time he came. And you saw what a fool he made of himself. Oh God, I hope that doesn't go on. But you saw the questions. You saw basically he couldn't answer any of the questions. He couldn't give straight answers to anything. And you saw at some point how even Mrs. Pei said that, you know, you don't call me my dear and all, just stick to the question. So when it comes to having all of these guys on a panel with people who are a little bit more informative about what is happening, it is super tough considering one simple talk, one talk about clearing out the doubts of us Goans, he couldn't really be on and answer clearly. But I don't think it's impossible, you know, if all, imagine all Goans, all youth collectively messaging and requesting their representatives to show up and to speak about what is happening and address all of this. It should be possible, but that's only going to happen if all of us continuously do this and if all of us put our heart and soul into really getting them on there. I don't think it's impossible. It should be possible, but people, common people, not political parties, nothing of that. So people like you and I need to get together to do this. So I think it's possible. I don't think it should be impossible.
Okay, the next question I think is, so what if we tweet and ask for them to present and have an interview with the rest, asking cause this will bring more light to what is going on and also have them accountable?
Yeah, so it's just like I said earlier, it is not impossible, but you know, this will only happen if all, I mean, there were quite a few people here. Now there's 40 of y'all. This will only happen if all 40 and plus a lot more hundreds of people start tweeting. There are still so many people who have not made Twitter accounts. It takes 2 minutes. Yeah, ask your friends, ask your family, make an account and start tagging them. Start holding them responsible. Send your questions to them. Ask them why they're not answering you. You have a right to ask them why they're not answering any of your questions. So if all of us, like if thousands of us continually take Twitter by storm, like, you know, even these Twitter storm sessions happen, if all of us do this, it is quite possible that they might just come and speak up. Or like, you know, I don't know if you all realize this, but till now, there has been no public statement made by them. There has been no, even according with regards to the protest, Mr. Pramod Sawant indirectly spoke about the protest to Herald, and he said that those who are protesting are opposing for the sake of it. What sake of it is he talking about? Are 30 people, are 40 people over here today for the sake of it? So you all need to catch all of these sentences that they say, you know, that contradict themselves, quote them, tag them and ask them, what are you talking about? For who? What? For the sake of it? I mean, we're risking our lives, we're going there, we're risking our family's lives, and we think we're doing it for the sake of it. So, you know, you need to catch all of these sentences that they speak about, tag them, quote them, tag all these people, all these journalists and all, and show them that these are the people we have elected. These are the people who are supposed to do something, and this is how they talk. This is literally how they are responding to us. And there's still no public statement made. So I think this is one of the ways that you can keep doing it. If there's public pressure, I mean, of course, they have to listen and they have to come forward and speak. If they don't, then it just shows you that, you know, our leaders are just not capable.
Okay, so we'll take the last question for today. Are there any alternatives to these projects?
Yes. So from what I have read, there were several alternatives, and we were the last one, by the way. We were the last alternative which was chosen. This is the reading that I have done. I could be wrong, so I really encourage you all to also read, but from what I have read, we were the last alternative. Even Mr. Claude Alvarez speaks about this on his talk with Faye D'Souza. And he says that there were alternatives, we were the last one and we were chosen. So there are more alternatives. And one of the alternatives that I can say is solar. So the rest of India, if you go to see, solar is actually pushed across and people are utilizing it. In Goa, Mr. Nilesh Cabral gave a 50% solar subsidy and said, okay, not many people opted for it. Only like 500 people took it. The rest have not been using it. So my question is, I mean, I cannot question, but it's something to think about. If the policy that Mr. Nilesh Cabral has put forth isn't working, do any of you all remember anything being pushed across about solar energy? And have you ever come across anything where the government tells you to opt for solar energy? No, at least I haven't. And I actually read about these things. So if the government puts across a policy and the people of Goa are not happy with it, why isn't the government trying to change their policy or trying to introduce a policy that will actually get the citizens involved? Isn't it the government's responsibility to have the citizens inspired to join a movement like that? When it comes to other things, they immediately push things forward and, you know, they try to like use their PR ahead. But why isn't the government trying to push across solar to all of us? Why aren't they inspiring the citizens of Goa to opt for solar? So even when it comes to this, I think you need to again ask questions about, you know, why you're not opting for solar? Why are you not pushing across for solar energy? And there are a few people that have been using solar that were on a talk previously. There's another talk that I think you all should really watch. It's about solar energy. I can't recollect the person's name, but it's a very informative talk. You should check out or save Molly, the talk is shared over there. And it basically speaks about solar energy and how as a renewable source, it is really good. So these are webinars that you should actually watch, and it will really help you all get a bit more informed about the alternatives that are possible.
I had a question for Valerie. If we wanted to start an agitation on ground, what are the steps we should take, and what are the things that we should be aware of?
Valerie, are you here?
I think surely Alfonso left.
Okay. I think we can forward that question to her and she can answer it later to us. Okay, so thank you Sherry, and thank you Valerie. You have been really good. Your talks and your question answers were really, the answers were really fantastic. So also, are you here? Okay, also so the participants who are still here with us, if you all could really put yourselves for, we could start taking this forward. We could have something like to do from now on as how we could address the situation. Would be really great if you all could come up with some 30-second video or a 1-minute video showcasing like how does this situation actually have a problem to you? How is it creating a problem? How would you want to address it? In just 2-3 lines, like if it's creating a problem for you, it's creating a nuisance for you, just like how you could how do you want to portray it? So either you can make a video of yourself, of a 30-second video or a 1-minute video, or even you could go ahead making play cards saying that save Mole and arrest me too with all those hashtags, and you can always tag my Mole or even say Mole Memory Project and just tag them, and then they will take it forward and they will see to it. And even if we do it on our DBYS page, we can post it on our DBYS pages, and then we can tag all the thing, and then that could be a small way forward to how we could go ahead from this webinar taking all the positives and trying to build up on it. And even you can, even if you don't want to make videos, you don't want to put yourself out there, your photo, you can even write down lyrics for songs, choreograph dances, or maybe even art in an art form, or even poems for that matter. You can just write something on Goa, how to protect Goa, how to save Goa, and we can take it forward from there, and then we can create a huge impact through the social media, and then even to ground level, if as how Valerie said, you can start at your own localities, in your own parishes. You can just start, form groups. If the groups are not there, just start groups, and then don't create separate groups. Form the groups and try to join in the existing groups already, so that we all combine our forces and we can move forward as one team, rather than just diverging our efforts in all the directions. Then we can just put it in one proper direction. So right now, we will be, I'll be posting a link in the chat box where there'll be a feedback form. You can just answer the feedback form, and then you can just help us to know exactly where we have gone wrong and what we could do better, and how we want to be a part of the DBYS Voices movement. So I'll just ask Father Alan if you could have a big picture of all of us smiling faces.
Noah, can Valerie respond to the question of Irvin? I think she's already online, and then we'll take the picture.
She's come back.
Yeah, Valerie.
Okay. Yeah, Valerie.
Yes.
Go ahead.
Yes. So the question is, yes. As youth, okay. So I'm a part of VDC Village Development Committee. I think the youth should be a part of it over there. You'll get a lot of information. You'll be out there. So that is one thing you can do as youth. For Molem issue, what is happening, I would again suggest that form your own groups. And then you can join with the organizations and then take on the movement which is happening. And what are the things you need to be aware of is what Captain has already spoken about. So if there's anyone who questions you, you need to be ready to give them answers. So that is one thing. And don't be blind box. If you do not know something, read about it. Inform, take all the facts that you know, keep it in your mind. Don't blabber, I would say. Read. I think my Molem page is doing a great thing. They're putting out all the facts, all the information, whatever we need. So read about it. That is one thing. And gather your friends. That is one thing you can do, which is more suitable for you guys out here. Gather your friends, form your groups, and then join any organization. So for now, the Chikalim Youth Farmers Club are doing a flash mob. I hope you have heard. If you've not heard, check online. So you can join us. We are doing an awareness campaign. We are joining Going to Equal. So you can come join us, or you can join GKN. So anything, whatever is suitable for you guys.
Thank you, Valerie. Okay, now I'm kindly requesting everyone to just turn on your video so that we can have a nice smiling group picture. Father Allen, are you ready?
All set.
Yeah. 3, 2, 1, everyone, my Goa.
All those who video on are not smiling.
Are what is wrong with everyone? Okay, Father.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Father. And now I request Annalie to just
Go ahead so I with the...
So I'd like to extend my gratitude to our speakers, Captain Viriath, Sherry Fernandez, as well as Valerie Afonso, for their inspiring and educative sessions. I'm sure we are all leaving this webinar much better informed about the key issues threatening Goa and what we can do to make a difference. A sincere thank you to Father Jason, Father Allen, and the organizing committee for conceptualizing this webinar and making it a reality. A note of gratitude to the Salesian priests who have joined us today. And last, but certainly not the least, I'd like to thank each and every one of you for making the time to attend this webinar and learn how you can take a stand for Goa. As we said before, we will be circulating a Google form. So do let us know the ways in which you can contribute to this cause. And we will also be sending the Citizens Action Toolkit sent by Sherry, as well as the PowerPoint by Captain Viriath, to those who have registered and provided your email IDs. And finally, thank you for joining us today and have a great Sunday.
Thank you, Annalie.